going to present us a powerful view of the Middle East today. And she grew up in a military family in the Air Force. She served in the Peace Corps. Has three children and eight grandchildren. Welcome, Alison Weir.
Introduction, especially getting in the eight grandchildren. I'd love to get I did grow up in a military family. For my father always felt that had been a very good career for him. He started out in the Army, then he joined the Army Air Corps, served in World War II in New Guinea, and then it became the U.S. Air Force. So that was his branch. Not everybody, of course, has had such a good experience with the U.S. military. And I think I'm with people here who have been mistreated by it. And I hope it's all right to mention that my little colleague who's doing our technology lost his father because of his experiences in Vietnam. Very, very sad reality. So there's more to this. But today it feels like I feel like I'm a little bit in church because all the front pews are empty. I'll start out, if I do this correctly, with two audiovisual things first. One will be what it's like when you work on this issue on Palestine and on the USS Liberty. And this is, I might need to find out how to press this. I'm just trying to. So this is an experience that I had back at the very beginning of when I began to work on this issue 20 years ago. Can you play the audio? This is a voicemail message I got on my phone.
Thank you for calling. You have 15 saved messages. To review, press 1. To scan, press 1-1. First saved message. Sent Friday, October 3rd at 2:02 a.m.
Hi. I heard your speech today, and you should burn through the debate. And I'm telling you this right now. On Monday, 2 p.m., you better not be in your office. Because me and my buddies, who are trained in the Israeli army, will come and kill every single one of you son of a bitches for what you're doing to destroy Israel. So watch out. This is not a joke. On Monday, you better watch out. Don't come to work. And close your organization or you're going to die.
That was 19 years ago, and I'm here. I won't say enough about the time. I won't take time. I was going to show a video, but there's so much I want to talk about that I'll go straight to my presentation. And I apologize, there's so much in this. I hope it's information that you're not disturbed to hear. A few of the photos will be disturbing. Most of them won't be, but there are a few. You can avert your eyes if you want to.
Alison, excuse me. We have some hard of hearing people back here in the back. Could you move the mic a little closer?
Yeah, let me see. This is maybe a little better.
Joe forgot his hearing aids.
Well, I would be among you saying the same thing if I were back there, so.
Thank you.
Is this better?
Yes. Wonderful.
Okay, great. Thank you. I thought tonight, or this morning, that I would tell how I became involved in this issue. I was honored to be asked to speak at your reunion about, I think, 15 or 16 years ago. I couldn't make it because my youngest son, Brett, was graduating from college that day. So today I'm happy to be here. And some people have asked me how I got involved, and I realized maybe that's what I should tell about today and some of what I've learned in the last 20 years. What happened in back in fall of 2000, I was the editor of a small weekly newspaper in Northern California, writing about the city council, the fishing fleet. The Middle East seemed distant, confusing, and irrelevant to my daily life. But then in fall of 2000, began a Palestinian uprising that's called the Second Intifada. That just means uprising, shaking off of oppression. And as we've just seen recently, for a brief time, the Israeli-Palestinian issue was in the news. And just out of curiosity, because I had never known much about that issue, I decided to pay attention to that news, just to learn what it was all about. And when I did, I noticed very quickly as a journalist that we were getting one-sided reporting from all our media, liberal media and conservative media. We were hearing from and about Israelis in great detail, as I wanted. I was very pro-Israel. But I noticed we weren't hearing much from Palestinians. I thought, well, there are two parties in this. I want the whole story. I think as Americans, we always want the whole story. And our media usually give us half of it, from one side or the other, that's on lots of issues. So I began to look into what was going on in the region itself, using that brand new thing of the time, the internet, and I saw some of what was going on. I saw a young boy had been shot by Israeli forces invading his neighborhood. I saw another young boy throwing stones against tanks, as many children were. And I thought, this is insane, this is crazy, what is this? I looked into it more and more, I started reading about it. I learned that Israel had attacked a U.S. Navy ship, that it had killed 34 Americans, injured over 170 of them. I'd grown up in a military family. I had never heard of that. I looked into it further. At one point, through happenstance, I learned that there was a survivor of that attack who lived in California, 8 hours away from me. I drove up to speak to Terry Habadier. He told me firsthand what had happened. So I began to discover, already in fall of 2000, what I thought was perhaps the biggest cover-up, the longest lasting, and the most enduring in covering both the left and the right that I had ever seen. And I still think it's the biggest cover-up I've ever seen. So after a few months of that, with my youngest child at college, out of the home, I decided to quit my job in Sausalito and to travel over to the Palestinian territories as a freelance reporter. I traveled very randomly and haphazardly throughout Gaza by myself with my notebook and my camera around the West Bank, various parts of Gaza, Rafah, Nablus, Jenin, etc. And I found that it was very different than we were being led to believe. I found that people, there were Christians there, of course, that's where Christianity began, as well as Muslims. I found people were very welcoming to me whenever they heard I was an American. They literally said, welcome. But I saw what was being done to them. These pictures are from my trip in February and March of 2001. Before a single rocket had been fired from Gaza, we always hear about rockets. This is what it looked like. These are my photographs. This is a residential neighborhood where full of families had been living. I took these pictures. I saw these people. That's what it looked like there. No rockets had been fired. Hamas was not in the leadership. This was in early 2001. I saw people being terrorized, many children being killed and shot. It was a very intense, very sad experience. I won't go into all the details of it, but I saw farmers whose land was being destroyed, and I thought, how will they feed their family? How does a farmer feed his family when all of his crops, his orchards, are destroyed? Remember, this is before it got even worse. I saw a lot of children who'd been shot, often in the back because they were running away from invading soldiers. Palestinians aren't invading Israel. Israel is coming into their neighborhoods and shooting them. They still do this every day. I talked to these children and their parents. I remember talking to one set of parents who were asking me if I could help their poor, destroyed son. I don't have his picture. And I thought maybe I could. Maybe I could take their son to a hospital in the United States, or maybe doctors could fly there. So I asked the doctor if something could be done. And the doctor told me in English, but the parents didn't speak English, that their son was totally and eternally paralyzed all four limbs. But he hadn't found the right way and time to tell them. So when I came, I remember at one point, I'll just briefly tell this one story. I went to a Palestinian newspaper office. Since Israeli forces shoot at them all the time, they had sandbags against the windows. And when I got there, they said, maybe you'd like to go see, a 9-year-old boy was just shot and killed nearby. And I thought, no, I wouldn't like to go see. But I was there for all of us, and I knew by then that we gave, at that time, Israel $8 million per day. So I knew we were connected to this. So I had to go, and I saw his home, I saw the living room, I saw the family photos on the wall. This is what they had in their home. They just moved in about 10 days before. And I saw the parents when they got home from the hospital, from their dead son. I saw the mother and the sisters weeping and weeping and weeping. The father was walking around shell-shocked. It looked to me like he was sleepwalking in a bad dream that would never end. I went to another funeral for a woman who had been killed. She had three sons, 18, 14, and 12. I talked to her neighbor, who said that her friend just a few days before had been asking what it was like to go to college in the United States, because her 18-year-old son wanted to go to college here. This woman told me it's every boy's dream in Palestine to go to college in America. But she said, of course, he won't go now. He'll stay home to help with his brothers. I saw the wall that's imprisoning them, imprisoning people in Bethlehem, the place I sing about every Christmas. This is what it looked like the last time I visited. Places that had been full of people on my previous visit were now destroyed, including an American school. So when I came back from that trip, I started an organization called If Americans Knew. Not political, not ideological, to give people the facts about all of these things, including the USS Liberty, which I tell about. Every time I've asked to speak anywhere in the country, I tell about the Liberty. We receive so much reporting on Israel-Palestine that we think we know what's going on. They always mention Palestinian rockets. They always mention, oh, poor Israel is defending itself from Palestinian rockets. Well, I saw what was going on long before those rockets were fired. They never tell us that the rockets, in most cases, are small, homemade projectiles that cause little damage and almost never even injuries. Since before the last few weeks, rockets had killed a total of 30 Israelis. Now I think it's approximately 35. That's how many have been killed by rockets the whole time they've been used. 35 people. Why doesn't the media tell us that? It's easy to ascertain. During that time, Israeli forces have killed in Gaza alone over 5,000. Americans want the whole story, not just little pieces of it. We hear about Israeli children who have been killed, and we grieve for them, as we should. But we almost never hear about the Palestinian children who were killed first and in far greater numbers. We would grieve for them, too, if we knew about them. I think we should know about all of those children. And it's important to notice that in the current round of violence that began in 2000, I believe it was 91 Palestinian children were killed before an Israeli child was then tragically also killed. But the media didn't tell us about this, that this was being done with our money. I counted up the cause of death for those 91 children. It's easy, this is all documented. The number one cause of death was gunfire to the head. I believe strongly that if Americans had known that our money was being used to shoot children in the head, we would have demanded that it stop. And I believe if we had done that, if all Americans had demanded that it stop, it would have. And then all those other Palestinian and Israeli children could be alive today. But they didn't tell us. But now, if enough people do it, if enough people learn about the Liberty and about what's going on, if enough people are brave enough to stand up and say, stop, we won't support this. All the children that will be in those columns in the coming weeks, months, and years, both Palestinian and Israeli, could be zero. Instead, families grieving for the rest of their lives. So when I began this organization, we did some media studies to really ascertain and to document how the media are covering this issue. I'll just mention a few of them. We looked at the first coverage of the current round of violence, the second intifada. And we especially looked at a subcategory, children killed, because I think we all feel children shouldn't be killed, no matter who they are, what nationality, what ethnicity, what race. Children should not be killed. So we found out how many had been killed, 28 Israeli children, 131 Palestinian children in that first year. How did our media cover it? Well, we discovered that our primetime network news shows covered Israeli children's deaths at rates up to 14 times greater than they reported on Palestinian children's deaths. On the rare occasions when an Israeli child was tragically killed, they not only covered it once, they often had a follow-up report on the death. On the frequent occasions when Palestinian children were killed, they usually never even covered it once, much less more than once. I'll skip through some of this. Another example was the Los Angeles Times, and this goes on all over, but I was living in Los Angeles at that time. And I saw the headline on their website that violence had broken a period of calm because there had been violence from Palestinians. Whenever Palestinians commit violence, they always say it shattered the calm. So I called up the LA Times because this hadn't been printed in their newspaper yet. It was very possible for them to correct that, to have an accurate headline. And I told them that during this period of relative calm, 170 Palestinian men, women, and children had been killed, and 379 had been injured during this so-called calm. They said, we said relative, and they didn't change a single word in their so-called news story. Another omission that I always tell about is 2003. I was there on Capitol Hill when the findings of the Independent Commission of the early attack on the USS Liberty was reported by Ephraim Moore, by Rear Admiral Merlin Starring. They announced that this had been an intentional attack. It had constituted an act of war by Israel against the United States. They reported that rescue flights had been recalled at the order of the president. All of the, extremely powerful statements by extremely high-ranking, highly respected military officers. Where was it on Fox News, the New York Times, NBC? Nothing. So when I first woke up to this, I began to read book after book after book. I will bring some copies of my book downstairs. I forgot to bring them. You will see in my book, it is literally half citations. I read so many books, I'm still reading them to learn about this issue. So here's, in brief, what I learned. How and when did the Israeli-Palestinian issue begin? How come we have this special relationship with a tiny country with virtually no natural resources, no oil? Why is this supposedly a strategic ally of the United States? One of the first things I learned about this issue when I finally took the time to study it for myself, not accept the media, study it for myself, I found that when I was born, and I suspect some of you may approach my age, so this would go for you too, when I was born, there was no Israel. It did not exist. There was Palestine. Palestine was a region, at that time under the British Empire, For centuries, it had been called Palestine, for probably millennia. So I discovered, well, when did the violence begin and how did this all happen? And I found that really, this all began in the late 1800s. The late 1800s, there was a movement called political Zionism that was begun in Europe, and very quickly, it turns out, in the United States. It was not a religious movement. Most religious Jews opposed it. But there was a movement called political Zionism. They held conferences in Switzerland. First one was in 1897. And they decided that they would take over Palestine for a Jewish state. Now, Palestine at that time was fully inhabited, an ancient land, so of course it was populated. The population was 80% Muslim, 15% Christian, and a little under Jewish percent, was a little under 5%. All living together without violence, as neighbors. They had lived that way for centuries without violence. So this movement began in Europe. Political Zionism was a movement to create a Jewish state in Palestine. That's what it means. This ideology, this political movement, has profoundly impacted the world. It has negatively impacted our country. And yet most of us, including myself, had never heard of it. When I went to a reunion of my high school class a while ago, very intelligent, patriotic, interesting people, I was sitting at a table, I said, by the way, do you know what Zionism is? And they said, well, I think I've heard that, what is it? You know, and here it's a movement, we've all heard of socialism, capitalism, fascism, communism, we sort of loosely know what they are. Here is Zionism, extremely important, and most people haven't even heard of it. Certainly don't know that it's operated in our country for over a century. It began, So already by 1910, there were 20,000 Zionists in the United States. It was already, according to a historian, becoming a movement to which congressmen listened, as they do today. In 1914, this is a really key thing to know. In 1914, a prominent attorney named Louis Brandeis, living in Boston, became the head of World Zionism. This isn't a conspiracy theory. This is all documented. There is such a thing as a World Zionist movement that still exists today. He became the head of it. A few years later, he was named by Woodrow Wilson to the Supreme Court. He's one of the most well-known Supreme Court justices, Louis Brandeis, and here it turns out he was the head of World Zionism. His biographer writes that. Most of us just don't know it. But it's even worse than that, because it turns out that he helped lead a secret Zionist society. Now, to me, even that sounds bizarre. What could I be talking about? So I will tell you specifically in this case where my information comes from. I read a book called Israel in the Mind of America by a very respected journalist, Peter Gross. He'd been a New York Times editor, diplomatic correspondent. He was at Harvard for a number of years. He wrote a number of well-respected nonfiction books. In his book, Israel in the Mind of America, published by a mainstream publisher, he wrote that Brandeis had been a leader of a secret society operating in the United States. Another place that's the source of my information on this is a book that is a publication in the American Jewish Historical Quarterly, a respected scholarly journal. The author of that piece was an Israeli historian, Dr. Sarah Schmidt. She is an expert on this issue. She wrote about the Parashim, a secret episode in American Zionist history. She also wrote a book that tells about it. These are my sources. I didn't make this up. I'm not that creative. I wouldn't have thought to make this up. But it turns out that there was an elite secret society that operated within the United States. They would go. They would recruit often young Harvard students where Brandeis was connected, and they would even swear a promise to the society when they became a member of it. They said, when they became a member of the society, until our purpose shall be accomplished, you will be a fellow of a brother whose bond you will regard as greater than any other in your life, dearer than that of family, of school, of nation. Brandeis was a leader in that, as was Felix Frankfurter, apparently, another Supreme Court justice. This has been going on in our country for a long time. The USS Liberty is a horrific tragedy and injustice, but it's just one of many impacts on our country and on Americans. This movement grew, different organizations were founded. By 1948, it had access to $150 million to use to propagandize Americans. In today's dollars, I think that's $1 billion or $1 trillion, I don't remember. Massive amount of money. So they targeted congressmen, clergy, Christian clergy, editors, professors, business and labor, Jewish war veterans. Because during this time, Jewish Americans were not Zionists. They said, we're Americans. You know, this has nothing to do with us. They didn't embrace this ideology. But they were propagandized quite a bit, and eventually many sadly did, but not all. They formed committees around the country to organize on behalf of Zionism against America. They distributed books, articles, etc. This is still going on. They worked to manufacture Christian support. They went to the churches. They began a front, a Christian front that they fueled. There's quite a bit of evidence, and your True News speaker that's coming up has done some excellent report on this, about their influence in a Bible. In a Bible that was distributed around the United States in the early 1900s, and still today, that has rewritten a number of things. The Scofield Reference Bible. During all of this time, there was opposition to Zionism by many, many different components of our country. Some of the most distinguished American pastors opposed Zionism. Some Jewish organizations publicly opposed Zionism. Diplomats, the State Department, the intelligence agencies, the Pentagon, all opposed Zionism, saying it would be harmful to the United States. The Secretary of Defense said no group in this country should be permitted to influence our policy to the point where it could endanger our national security. There was report after report, memo after memo, all warning politicians that supporting the Zionist movement would be harmful to the United States, would cause bloodshed among Americans, as we have seen. But they were ignored by politicians then as now, because then as now, politicians from both parties share one goal, and that is to be elected. And the Zionist lobby already, at the time of Truman and his opponent, were funding both parties. So if you didn't do what they wanted you to do, the money would go to the other party and your opponent would win. So, President Harry Truman said, and I'm not picking on Truman, this is what both parties have said, basically, to all of his experts telling him, including his Secretary of State, he said, I'm sorry, gentlemen, but I have to answer to hundreds of thousands who are anxious for the success of Zionism. I do not have hundreds of thousands of Arabs among my constituents. His campaign was funded in large part by Zionists. And he did what he knew was the wrong thing, and he did later regret it. So then, I'll skip through a lot of this, but what happened is that Britain had become in charge of Palestine after World War I because of the U.S. influence, really. And then there was violence in the area. So finally, Britain decided that they would turn the question of Palestine over to the United Nations to solve. Because there was violence between the Zionists against the British, with the indigenous Palestinian population. They proposed a partition plan in which over half of the land would be given to Israel, and less than half of their own land would be for Palestinians. Imagine if the UN told Americans, we're giving away over half of your land, but you get, 45%. I don't think we would accept it. And yet Palestinians are always said, they just turned down this wonderful opportunity. Who would accept such a wonderful opportunity? So that doesn't have any force of law. The UN did not create Israel. Israel was created through warfare. What a distinguished Israeli historian who wrote a book about it, several books, calls it the ethnic cleansing, the war of ethnic cleansing, in which they pushed out at least 750,000 men, women, and children, both Christians and Muslims, out of their land, off their ancestral land. They lost their homes so that they could, and then instead take the area over. They decided to name it Israel. By the way, the name was chosen at the last minute. They considered several other names, but then they decided they would name it Israel. One journalist tried to tell Americans about it. She wasn't the only one, but she was the main one. She is considered one of the most important female journalists of the 20th century, and I had never heard of her. We see this erasing again and again. I'd never heard of the Liberty. I'd never heard of Dorothy Thompson, who was enormously famous. She had a radio program listened to by millions of Americans. She was such a celebrity that there was a Hollywood movie loosely patterned on her life. She was played by Katharine Hepburn. There's a Broadway play. She was played by Lauren Bacall. She was one of the first American journalists to warn of the Nazis. She was expelled by Hitler. So she was sympathetic to Zionism. But then she went over to Palestine. She saw what was going on. And she began to write and speak of them. She lost her job. She lost her livelihood. She lost her fame. And as her biographer writes, she was erased from history. Today we have some Israel partisans, and again, this is not all Jewish Americans, many of whom oppose this. But for example, look at this. The American history magazines, they have ones about military, Civil War, aviation, Vietnam. The owner of this is Eric Weider, who's an Israel partisan. When we tried to put an advertisement in one of their magazines for a book by Paul Finley, a Republican congressman from Illinois, Eric Weider said, we will never publish anything because you are anti-Israel. That's the kind of control that we have in our country. It's even worse than this. It's one of these things where year by year I learned more, and it was, usually things are better. Both sides often, in a political conflict, often both sides have valid points. We need to hear from each other and talk to each other, especially today with the polarization going on. But in some cases, the more you look into it, the worse it becomes. So the more I discovered is that not only this, but Israel decided, they did this ethnic cleansing, so they've got Palestinian refugees around the region that they want to prevent from coming home. Those other countries might support the Palestinian refugees' right to return home. So they had to destabilize and damage every country in the region. And they began talking about this from 1954, shortly after their founding. They talked about plans to destabilize and harm every country in the region. This was continued in 1982. There was a plan talking about how they needed to cause harm to Syria, to Iraq, to Lebanon, to Iran. 1996, there was a group of Americans called the Project for a New American Century that were working to shape Israel's regional environment. General Wesley Clark spoke about this in San Francisco at the Commonwealth Club, a major mainstream venue. He said that that group had committed a policy coup in the United States. You can see the video on YouTube. It's a very strong statement. He said they wanted us nuts, so they wanted to use the U.S. They destabilized these countries themselves, but pretty soon they had us do it. They wanted us to destabilize the Middle East, turn it upside down, make it under control, our control, and they did. They succeeded. We invaded Iraq for Israel. This is a strong statement. Think of all the tragedy and death from that invasion. To Americans, to Iraqis, to the entire region. The fact that it was Zionists that pushed the U.S. into this was written openly in the Israeli media. A well-known Israeli daily newspaper wrote, "The war in Iraq was conceived by 25 neoconservative intellectuals who are pushing President Bush to change the course of history." And what I edited out from this is they said, the article actually said, by 25 neoconservative intellectuals, most of them Jewish, who are pushing President Bush to change the course of history. Another journalist in Israel wrote, "Pearl, Faith, Fife, and their fellow strategists are walking a fine line between their loyalty to American governments and Israeli interests." So we invaded Iraq and we had all of those tragedies. That led to ISIS. That led to the other growing destabilization throughout the Middle East. An email from Hillary was revealed because of WikiLeaks. That's why the WikiLeaks is under such attack. She said the best way to help Israel is to overthrow the regime of Bashar al-Assad in Syria. So Syria has been destroyed. And now we have Syrian refugees all over. And the violence, of course, is spilling over into Europe. And now they want us, we destroyed Iraq. Bad enough. But they're not done. Now we're supposed to destroy Iran. I'd like to show you next a newspaper advertisement that was in the New York Times several years ago, 10 years ago. I happened to be in the area at that time and saw this in person, a full-page advertisement in the New York Times. That's very expensive, and very influential. So this advertisement had a big picture, and at the bottom, it had the icons, the symbols for the organizations that had paid for that advertisement, which is very useful. Usually they wouldn't have done that, but I think they wanted to brag that they had put it in to show their donors, look at what we put in the newspaper. So I now have an image where I make the list from those icons so you can really see who paid for that advertisement. So here's an advertisement against Ahmadinejad, making him look diabolical, saying that we have to worry about their funding terror, all of this and look at that. Well, here's who funded that advertisement. And remember, we're getting lots of Iran, anti-Iran propaganda. Some is factual information, much of it is non-factual. This was put in by the American Israel Public Affairs Committee, APAC, the Conference of Presidents of Major American Jewish Organizations, the Jewish Council for Public Affairs, Jewish Federations of North America. Why are they talking about Iran? American Jewish Committee, which is actually an international organization. The Anti-Defamation, the ADL, supposedly works against defamation. Why are they talking about Iran? United Synagogue of Conservative Judaism, Jewish Reconstructionist Federation, Hadassah, that's the women's group, National Council of Jewish Women, and on and on and on. So now, as I mentioned, we have, there is growing extremism. Stemming from all of this has created increased extremism. So we've seen tragedy in Belgium, in France, children dying in Europe because of this. We saw a little Syrian boy on a beach dead. Almost nobody saw this little Palestinian boy before that on a beach dead. All of this on behalf of Zionism. Iran, there are children in Iran too. I don't want next to see them dead on a beach. Thank you.